views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
A ban, a pause, a suspension, they're all terms used to describe President Donald Trump's recent immigration executive order. Lawyers on both sides are making their case in court. Reaction and disapproval, as well as support, is being echoed all across the world. Coming up on this Digital Perspectives, we'll discuss how Muslims from the Bronx are reacting and what the court ruling could mean if the ban is upheld. This and a whole lot more on this Digital Perspectives with yours truly, Darren Hyman.
What's on your mind?
Let him know.
What's on your mind? What's on your mind?
Let him know.
Anything relevant to life, you bring it to the table. Whether you make a move solo or a movement with a stable. No fables, you speak on your decisions. Cause in the long run, it's your voice, your views, your vision. Keeping it real with many messages for you to know. This ain't radio, but DJ runs the show. Entertainment, he rocks it. Politics, he locks it. The host with the most would handle any topic. Don't forget to share your perspective, which shines a light. Cause it might make a difference in someone else's life.
What's your perspective?
And hello, everyone. Welcome to another Digital Perspectives. I am Darren Hyman. Of course, we thank you for watching and staying connected to us. You can stay connected to us in a variety of different ways. Of course, always live here on BronxNet, Channel 67, Verizon Fios, that's Channel 33, or anytime in the World Wide Web, BronxNet.org. And then also, you can hit us on social media. We are on Facebook and BronxNet Perspectives. We're on Twitter. And then also, you can catch me on my professional page, Darren C. Hyman, where we give you information about what's happening in and around the community. But on this particular edition of Perspectives, going front and center, talking about the Muslim ban that is raising questions and anger and ire across the United States and across the world. As President Trump signed the executive order issuing a ban from seven countries into the United States, it caused a widespread chaos, and not just chaos, but directly affected and indirectly affected hundreds of thousands of people trying to make entry into the United States and families here. Here to share a little bit more about exactly what that means for us locally. We're pleased to have Sheikh Musa Dramani, who is the chairman of the Islamic Cultural Center. No stranger to being a guest here on Perspectives, and welcome.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you for having me. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, too. And I don't know how happy it is right now, because a lot of people are asking the question about this executive order and the local effect. So let's talk about the president signs this executive order. And you've got seven countries that have been affected. But give us a local perspective from what you know of how things have been affected here in the borough of the Bronx.
Well, I mean, the fact remains here in the Bronx, you know, the majority of the deli owners and small businesses are in the hands of the Dominicans and the Yemenis. And Yemen is one of the seven countries that is affected. But I think what the Muslim community is dealing with is broader than just these initial seven countries. Donald Trump ran on a platform of banning Muslims until he knows, you know, what to do with them. So because of that, now he's trying to run away from the same statement. And then a couple of days ago, Giuliani came and said Donald Trump actually asked him to find a way to do it legally. So we don't know how it's going to end, but we do not believe, you know, it'll bring a positive outcome.
As a Muslim, how do you feel about the president and his thoughts towards banning Muslims from the United States?
Well, as a Muslim, you know, we know for certain that he is crazy, and he is very, very unqualified, because, you know, Muslims are the biggest victims of extremism. You know, if you're going to fight extremism or terrorism from the Islamic world, your best asset is the Muslim world. Your best allies would be the Muslims, because the fact remains 95% of the victims of terrorism and extremism are within the Muslim community. And for us to be here, knowing the basic functionality of the government, knowing the basic separation of these powers, and to listen to him to talk like a child, as if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. No, you can't do it. There's a role that you can play, but not everything that you want to do. And because of what he said during the campaign, I think his lawyers are having a very, very difficult time just to narrow it down to just these seven countries. So the Muslim community is very, very angsty as to what else is in the package.
What's the sentiment right now, given the fact that we've had attacks in mosques? We've seen that happen. We know what the president wants to do. What's the mood and what's the sentiment of Muslims around, from your perspective?
Well, Darren, this is a country that has a very, very mature political system. And I think what makes this country better than any other country is the fact that you have the freedom of the press, which digs deep into anything that would have been hidden, number one. Number two, also the separation of powers. These are the two most important qualities. So the Muslim community, majority of the Muslim community are well-educated, well-positioned, and they're entrepreneurs. They know that all these things will die out. But unfortunately, in the meantime, people are suffering because you have people who took their families and liquidated everything and kissed goodbye to their loved ones and heading to what they believe would be their final destination and come to the airport and having to be turned back to the same place that they just said goodbye to. It'll affect, families, in more ways than unfortunately, we can bear. But I think in the long run, everything will die out and, the country will continue to progress.
We'll take a look at Terminal 4 at JFK Airport right now. And Terminal 4 at JFK Airport was the site for the protest that happened immediately following the executive order being signed by the president. And we saw thousands of people proceed to Terminal 4. We just saw some pictures of that. But in addition to that, across the United States, how effective do you think the protests were in getting to the place where we had this temporary stay against the executive order?
Well, it is very, very effective because people came out and people saw Donald Trump that we are in charge, we employ you. It's not you who decides whatever you wanna decide. And what also makes it very, very embarrassing is that the same leaders that they employ as a translators and informers and assets on the ground who understand the culture, the language, who can walk them through trenches were denied entrance to a point where it was very, very embarrassed, to the government. Even politicians cried because they know that if these people sacrifice everything just to help our military, to help us succeed, why would we embarrass them? Why would we tell the whole world, especially their enemies, that you were dealing with cowards? This is how they treat you. You help them, but these are cowards. And because of that, Donald Trump will lose. And this is something that he can never ever recover from because it is the beginning of his administration and he blundered it. So right now, things can die out, but he cannot heal from it. It's an embarrassment to the nation and it is an embarrassment globally because people understand that he is the most unqualified person who ever occupied the White House. And from now on, people will second guess every move he makes, right or wrong.
What conversations are you having amongst yourselves as, at the Islamic Community Center, across mosques, given the fact that the heightened state of tensions and the way that they are right now? What's the word? What's being said?
We thrive through difficulties. You see, there's a verse in our holy book that says, for every challenge, there's an opportunity. What we're doing now is we are mobilizing and strategizing more than any time before to show these kids, to show our friends, to show our families that you are a part of this nation. And your job now is to go and get the best education you can get and be active. And most importantly, register and vote. Register and vote, register and vote. If you look at the voter turnout in New York State, it's dismal. Mayor de Blasio was elected by what? 10% of the voting population. So I promise you, come next election, whether it is a local election or national election, you will see the largest Muslim and immigrant population voting and mobilizing and strategizing and holding civic forums than any time before. Because this nation is built based on immigrants, fresh blood. The comptroller, I think in January 16, brought a report that says immigrants control 83,000 businesses in New York City, which is about 51% of all the businesses in New York City, immigrants. And they, collectively, they earn $100 billion. This is only the city. So you cannot go against the economic engine of the immigrants. 83,000 businesses owned by immigrants, which is 51% larger than the native New Yorkers, and they earn $100 billion. He is crazy to go against the tide of the powerful force of immigrants.
And what Sheikh is referring to is a report that came out by New York City Comptroller Scott Stringer, that recent report showing the amount of money that actually is raised through immigrant revenue here in New York City. Stay with us, taking a quick break. When we come back, we're going to talk a little bit more with the Sheikh, and we're going to talk a little bit about understanding the Muslim culture and awareness. Is there a better awareness, or have things gotten better or worse? Stay with us. We're coming right back right after this.
Wow, these are really good.
You act surprised. Practice makes perfect.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you.
There's one thing you can never have sex without.
It's not something you buy.
Or something you take.
In fact, there's only one way to get it.
It has to be given to you, freely.
It's consent.
Because sex without it isn't sex.
It's rape. Consent.
If you don't get it, you don't get it. It's on us to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Me and my boy Matt had it good. He had catnip that was off the hook. But one day, he brings a girl home, and she's allergic to cats. Every sneeze was a nail in my coffin. Now I'm in a shelter. It's decent, but they don't even have Wi-Fi.
Continuing our conversation here with Sheikh Musa Drami, talking about the Muslim ban or the travel ban that's been enacted through President Trump's executive order, barring seven countries from entering into the United States, 120-day ban. But that ban has been temporarily upheld as of this show, with the matter going before the courts. And we know that that's before the appellate court. Were you surprised that the appellate courts were able to just jump in and be able to deal in this kind of way and say, listen, you know what, there's an executive order, but we find different? Were you surprised?
No. We were not surprised. And, you know, things have been done, in a way that is normal. I mean, even a common man understands that certain things cannot be done. Donald Trump's circle, according to reports, you know, most of them didn't even know what was going on. So you have these individuals who are in the leadership position, who should be in the know and were surprised to hear this from the media. That is very, 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 you know, careless, you know, leadership. So we're not surprised. Mm.
Talk about extreme radicalization, because I think that's what a lot of people are worried about. I think the president has actually articulated that. People are, you know, concerned when you have ISIS, and we're talking about the radicalization locally, extreme. And it seems to be somewhat, on some fronts, people feel like it's growing. Mm-hmm. Other people feel as though things are diminishing. But what can we do in terms of, because it seems to be a growing number, but what can we do possibly locally that we're not talking about when it's talking about extreme radicalization?
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, I would say, you know, radicalism as we know it now come from two excuses. Mm-hmm. Number one, they are in a failed societies. You know, the Muslim world has failed its population. That's number one. Number two, the Western powers, you know, corrupt and unjust action in internationally. Even if you look at the problem in Syria, you know, how many superpowers are there bombing every single day? You look at Yemen, you look everywhere, people are bombing and bombing. Bombing for what? Bombing for somebody's resources or strategic positioning. So these are the two reasons why now you have these, I would call them reactionists. These are criminals who have absolutely positively no holding onto Islam, but they happen to be Muslims. They may live in a Muslim nation, and Islam is the only tool that they can use to recruit like-minded people. Otherwise, how would they recruit other people? How would you convince someone that dying is better for you than living? I mean, how could you go to a man and woman and convince that man, say that suicide bombing will give you better than living with your family? So now, in order for us now to eliminate or at least lessen the effect of extremism, number one, we should never ever utilize anti-Islamic elements, because Muslims suffer more in the hands of extremists than anybody else. Therefore, associate with Muslims in order to defeat radicalism. You do not use anti-Islamic elements as we see now in the White House, where Islam is the problem. Islam is not the problem. Islam is the victim, and Islam is also the solution. Extremism occurs in every society, in every religion, in every culture. A couple of days ago in Kenya, a young white extremist walked into the mosque and killed six innocent people, all of them highly successful Canadian immigrants. And a couple of months ago last year, same white extremists walk into a church and even pray with people. They had a hospitality on his behalf, yet he murdered them. Our problem here is to differentiate the criminals from a peaceful religion. Islam is very peaceful. You have 1.6, 1.7 billion Muslims, 95% of the casualties from these extremists occur, you know, in innocent Muslims. So whether it is the West, the politicians, the military, in order to defeat any type of extremist that embodies Islam as their platform, you must work with Muslims. But you should never ever blame Islam for extremism. Islam is the best form of counter-extremism.
What do we do in terms of awareness? Because obviously you talk about radicalization, you talk about working with the Islamic and Muslim community, and there has to be a better awareness across across, you know, the United States and across the world about the Muslim lifestyle, about Islam. Because as we said, I've got imams, and we know imams, we know many in the Muslim community who are just great, hardworking people, good, hardworking people. But unfortunately, through media and other things, the stereotype that's always presented is that of the extremist, of the extremist culture. What do we do? How do we go about breaking down these stereotypes and getting to a place of awareness and understanding you're my brother and not my enemy?
Well, we got to be truthful. The number one thing that we need is truth. When we're truthful, then we can expose these extremist lobbyists who are, number one, liars. They profit from conflict. And by the way, have you ever seen any picture shown ISIS and Al-Qaeda with broken down cars or old arms? You wouldn't see. They have the latest model arms, and they drive the best vehicle you don't even see in the Bronx. Where would they get it? These cars are not being made in the Middle East. The weapons are not being made in the Middle East. Who supplied them these weapons? Who supplied the bullets? Who are giving them these communicating tools? The first thing we have to do in order to defeat any type of extremism is we got to be truthful. You cannot supply weapons to any group in the Middle East and expect them now to be your puppet. It's not going to happen, because the moment one battle is over, now they become your enemy. All the weapons in the Middle East come from the West. Every single one of them supplied by the West. Every single gun supplied by the West. Every single communicating tool supplied by the West. Every training is done by the Western military. The first thing we have to do in order to eliminate radicalism is to be truthful, because all the power come from right here. Only the lies circulate, but the truth, Washington knows the truth. Their army, one faction versus the other one. In Yemen now, they have so many different, by the way, in Syria, they have over 1,000 different factions. Everybody's arming one group to fight the other group. Now, when the fighting stopped, guess what happened? These groups will come together, and now these groups are Syrian, they're Muslims, they're whatever, they become common enemy to the West. Now, another war. Same thing happened in Iraq. Same thing in Afghanistan. The first thing we have to do is we have to be truthful and identify these lobbyists who are behind the scene promoting this conflict and going to the media and lie to their teeth. Unless we're truthful, we're just wasting the innocent blood of our young military people who are sending to these wars based on lie and fabrication and profit.
Come back with more with Sheikh Musa Drama. We'll be right back right after this.
Being prepared is a part of who you are, but it's especially important in the case of a disaster. Be informed about possible emergencies in your area. Make a plan that covers where you go in an emergency. Build a kit with the things you need to survive. There's no one more capable of planning for your situation than you. Start your plan today. Go to ready.gov/myplan.
Hey, did you know 2.4 million loving cats and dogs in shelters and rescues need our help to find a home? Let's go to theshelterpetproject.org and meet a few who are in a shelter near you. Harlow. Oh, she's one great listener who loves to hear all your stories. My kind of cat. Cerulo. Is a sweet, goofy boy who's eager to please. Sounds just like another dog I know. So go to theshelterpetproject.org, search your local shelters and rescues, and go for a cuddle with your next best friend, a dog.
Back here with Sheikh Musa Drami, wrapping up our conversation, talk a little bit about, it all started with talking about President Trump's executive order and the fight to really do away with this. If this ban is done away with, do you feel like the battle is won and over?
No, Darren, the Muslims love nothing more than to live in a secure land. Muslims are refugees. They're asylum seekers. They're victims from the land that they're, running away from. They do not want the same exact problem follow them here. I guarantee you. Muslims want nothing better than to live in the most secure nation. And if the government understand that and work with the Muslim community instead of attacking the Muslims, you will have the most harmonious relationship. There is no Muslim family that will run away from Syria and come here to be in conflict. Nobody will do it from Yemen, nothing. So all we have to do now is we have to create a system whereby we said our goal is to weed out the bad guys. And the bad guys cannot be weed out when you paint, brush the entire religion as bad guys, as Donald Trump did when he was running. That's why he's having problem now. If he did not say anything, then he has the power, to sign this exit. But he had said what he was going to do, and he had asked Giuliani to legalize it. Now he wants to run away from it, but it's not going to happen. The Muslims want to live in a nation that is safe and secure, and every nation has laws. And we must obey the laws. We must follow the rules and regulations. But you do not attack the entire religion as a bunch of criminals. Just like what he did with the Mexicans. The best thing you can do with Mexico is to honor them, to work with them. How could you insult Mexicans at the same time you want them to stop whatever you want them to stop? Donald Trump is normalizing what can never ever be normalized. Unfortunately, no matter how vicious, no matter how indecent, no matter how, untruthful, he just wants to normalize it. And the media in the beginning, they couldn't resist because of the ratings and the money that Donald Trump brings. But now it is too late to stop him, because now he is awarded with the highest decision-making office in the world. And in the next 4 years, only God knows what will happen. But the Muslims in general want peace and laws to be obeyed here in the United States.
Are you fearful?
No, I'm not fearful. Actually, as I said before, every challenge gives us the opportunity. Right now, since in the last 2 weeks, I've been busier than any time. And the more I meet people, the more I educate them, the more we have numbers willing to take on tasks that were almost impossible before. I'm very optimistic that at the end of everything, you will see the strongest Muslim, the strongest immigrant blacks that this nation have ever seen, because people are angry and they're upset and people are embarrassed. I'm telling you, you know, we get calls and, you know, Facebook postings from international, they're embarrassed. They couldn't believe that America will elect such unqualified person like Donald Trump, and everything about Donald Trump is an embarrassment to this nation, and the nation will pay a price by having him there, because the guy will never change. He cannot change. From get-go, he normalized indecency and lie, and now he's governing based on indecency and lies, and the world is embarrassment. I'm very hopeful, and I'm stronger. I'm not scared of anything.
Sheikh Musa Drama, how do people get in touch with you? They want to have a conversation or find out more?
Absolutely. I mean, my telephone number is 718-822-5555, and my, you know, website is muslimcommunityreport.com, muslimcommunityreport.com.
All right, Sheikh Musa Drama, thank you once again.
Absolutely, thank
good
you.
To have you. Anytime. Peace and blessings to you.
Absolutely, thank
and,
you.
And hopefully we'll see you soon. Sheikh Musa Drama, our guest here on Perspectives. As always, continue to stay connected to us. We're going to bring you more with regards to some of the president's executive orders and how exactly that affects on a local level. And sometimes we don't understand how Washington actually plays out in our local homes. But here's a perfect case and example of how decisions in Washington have a direct and indirect effect, particularly right here in the borough of the Bronx. So stay with us, and not just the Bronx, but New York City. So stay with us connected here at Perspectives. Darren Hyman, we got to get out of here. Until next time we meet, stay safe, share your perspective with somebody else. It just might make a difference in somebody else's life. Because it might make a difference in someone else's life. Make a difference. What's your perspective? Express what's in your heart and your mind. Share your perspective. What's your perspective? Let them know. What's on your mind? What's on your mind? Anything relevant to life, you bring it to the table. Whether you make a move solo or a movement with a stable. No fables to speak on your decisions, cause in the long run it's your voice, your views, your vision. Keeping it real with many messages for you to know. This ain't radio, but DJ runs the show. Entertainment, he rocks it. Politics, he locks it. The host with the most would handle any topic. Don't forget to share your perspective, which shines a light, cause it might make a difference in someone else's life. They said I have troll teeth.
That my voice sounded like a possessed baby doll.
That no one would ever love someone as stupid as me.
That I was fat. Ugly.
Disgusting.
The effect of bullying is potent.
We will no longer be the silent majority.
Now, when you see online bullying, there's something you can do about it.
We're gonna take action with the eye.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness, and so are you. You're